Ladies and gentlemen, our final panel discussion for the day is on the theme South Asia, Prospects and Prognosis. To chair this session, I would like to invite Dr. Duvuri Subbarao, Distinguished Visiting Fellow, ISAS, and former Governor of the Reserve Bank of India. To join Dr. Subbarao, I would like to invite the principal speaker for the panel, Ambassador George Moose, and the following distinguished speakers, Professor Raja Mohan, Associate Professor Razeen Sally, and Professor K.S. Nathan.
First of all, welcome to this last and final session of the conference, and arguably the most important. I say it's the most important because it is focused on South Asia prospects and prognosis, and is expected to pull together all the discussion of the earlier sessions and look ahead to South Asia's prospects and prognosis. If you recall, the conceptual map of this conference, we had the plenary session in the morning, followed by a session on South Asia and global politics, the state of play, where you heard about what ISAS is doing and is going to do in order to better understand and educate Singapore and educate South Asia on each other. The second session was on South Asia to the West, the third session on South Asia to the East. And finally, just before this, we had the global developments in South Asia. So this session is expected to bring together and look ahead at South Asia's prospects from the prisms of ISAS's research foci, diplomacy, democracy, defense, development, and diaspora. The panel we have comprises, obviously, thought leaders and subject matter specialists, but the organizers have also told me that this panel is somewhat self-selected because they've been identified on the basis of their remarkable expertise to keep interest going in the very last session of this conference. So it's my pleasure first to invite Ambassador George Moose to give the main opening speech for the session. He's had a long and distinguished career in the United States Foreign Service, served in Africa, served in the UN system with great distinction. And in 2007, he was appointed by the White House to the Board of Directors of the U.S. Institute of Peace, in which institution he has now risen to the position of the Vice Chairman. In his role as the Vice Chairman of the U.S. Institute of Peace, he has followed closely the Institute in the involvement in its involvement in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, as well as its engagement with India and China in understanding and addressing the drivers of conflict throughout the region. Ambassador Moose.
Thank you, Dr. Subbarao, for that kind introduction. My thanks as well to ISAS for the invitation to address this extremely distinguished gathering. However, I do have a disclaimer to make, which is that I can in no way pretend to be an expert on South Asia. However, I have had the privilege for the past 10 years to work with a number of people who can make that claim, my colleagues at the U.S. Institute of Peace in Washington. And I've had the benefit, therefore, of their wisdom in preparing my remarks for you this afternoon. But let me be clear that what I'm about to say is strictly my own personal view and not that of the Institute. It's been a long day. We've been treated to a very rich diet of ideas and observations. I'm not sure how much appetite remains in the room for more discourse. But my response to that will be to try to be brief and to the point. Now, I have a very strong suspicion that one reason, important reason, that I was invited to participate in this conference is because there was perhaps some hope that someone might shed some light on the attitudes of the new administration in Washington and the approach that it might take towards this important region of the world. I'll do my best, but I suspect I'm also going to disappoint you, because the truth of the matter is that there is so much about the future directions of the new administration that is at this point unknown and uncertain. And therefore, it's very hard to give you a clear sense of direction. The recent departure of General Michael Flynn, who was President Trump's first choice to be his national security advisor, has only added to that uncertainty. That said, in January, the Institute, U.S. Institute of Peace, had the privilege of hosting an event which we called Passing the Baton. It was an all-day gathering which featured both the outgoing national security advisor, Susan Rice, and the then incoming national security advisor, General Flynn, who shared the stage together. And with them, there were a number of other senior officials from both the outgoing administration and the incoming administration. And the whole purpose was to have them both share and listen to the ideas, the thoughts about the issues that were confronting the United States and hence would confront the new administration. It was an extraordinary event. It ushered in what we called an era of good feeling. Alas, that era didn't last too terribly long. But nevertheless, for that brief moment, there was a fair amount of compatibility, or at least sharing of thoughts and ideas, which is a reminder that notwithstanding the fact that this is a significant change in American politics, it is also, it nevertheless remains true, that, and especially in the area of foreign policy, that that policy is a combination of both continuity and change. And so when we think about this, I think it would be a mistake to say, to suggest, or to believe that what we are going to witness the evolution of the new administration's policy will be entirely new. One of the things that emerged from that conference that we did in January, Passing the Baton, was that it was clear that while South Asia would indeed be an important area of the world and concern for the new administration, it probably will not figure among the administration's top priorities. If one has followed the discussion in Washington, one will know that certain issues already have assumed quite considerable importance. Among them, certainly Russia. In that context, the U.S. relationship with both NATO and the European Union. And we know that both the vice president was dispatched only last week to Europe to assure our allies in Europe of the continuity of U.S. commitment to that alliance. We know as well that China will be among the high priorities for a whole variety of reasons, issues of trade and economics, but also continuing concerns in the area of China's security policies, particularly in the South China Sea. We know from that event and from subsequent comments by the senior officials of the administration that there are two other issues that are already emerging, looming as priorities. One of those is Iran, and the other is North Korea. And all of you, of course, will know that those issues and those relationships, the relationship with Russia and China, the issues of Iran and North Korea, all impinge directly and indirectly on what happens in South Asia. So the fact that the issue that the region of South Asia will not in and of itself probably not occupy those top-tier issues means that, in all likelihood, the management of our relations with the region will be left to, dare I say, the working level, that is to say, the undersecretaries and the assistant secretaries and the departments of defense and state. But even there, and one might say that that's probably not a bad thing. But even then, the exact outlines of that policy are unclear, precisely because the administration still is very much in the process of staffing up. By last count, other than Secretary of State Tillerson, and there was only one other senior official at the undersecretary level in the State Department, Tom Shannon, one carryover. There is a lot of work to be done, in other words, to fill out the staffing of the machinery of our international security and foreign policy establishment. So with that, let me at least try to sketch out some of the factors that are certain to shape the new administration's perspective on South Asia. And it probably, we've had a lot of talk about issues of economics and connectivity, culture, education, other kinds of exchanges, but it probably won't come as a surprise to you that the factors that are going to loom largest in the minds of the senior officials in the new administration in Washington are going to be security. So with that, let me start inevitably with Afghanistan. The war in Afghanistan is almost certain to continue to dominate U.S. concerns and shape how the U.S. engages with the region, and particularly with Pakistan. But it's unclear whether the administration will be willing to commit to a strategy designed to achieve a reconciliation among the parties to the Afghan conflict, something that many observers believe is key to not only ending the conflict, but to establishing some sort of sustainable stability in the region. The previous administration pursued this kind of a strategy, but it was unable to secure agreement between the internal and the external parties to the conflict over an agenda for negotiation and a process for talks. Without reconciliation, the current conflict trajectory in Afghanistan points towards a continuing attrition of forces on both sides, the degradation of state control outside of major population centers, an increased internal political conflict over a diminishing resource base. Although U.S. support for the Afghan government and security forces appears likely to continue through the medium term, and indeed may even increase in the short term in response to General Nicholson's assessment and his call for additional forces. In the worst case scenario, the possibility of a state breakdown cannot be dismissed. This could, in turn, put further pressure on neighboring states and the world, with refugees, for example, seeking to escape the conflict, as many already have. And this would be a major concern, needless to say, for the U.S. and for the region. That brings me next to Pakistan. U.S. relations with Pakistan were likely to deteriorate regardless of who won the elections in November. And this can be attributed to fundamental divergences between Pakistan and the U.S. with respect to Afghanistan, as well as nuclear worries and geopolitical tensions between the US, China, and India. We saw these tensions under the Obama administration, and both sides, US, Pakistan, made efforts to maintain a working relationship on issues of counterterrorism cooperation and periodic efforts and pushes towards an Afghan reconciliation process. But the breakdowns in that process, as well as disputes over things like drone strikes and U.S. counterterrorism operations, notably related to the haven provided to the Afghan Taliban in Pakistan, all kept the relationship on edge. Adding significantly to these concerns are, of course, the tensions over Pakistan's nuclear program and the relations with India. Pakistan will likely be put under more pressure by the new administration and by the Congress, which will be less inclined, less subtle, and more impatient, and which in turn raises the possibility of a further deterioration in U.S.-Pakistan relations. That brings me next, of course, to India. India is almost certain to remain a key U.S. partner, or certainly the administration will wish to continue to see it as a key U.S. partner. And that's diplomatically, economically, and increasingly militarily. Strengthening this relationship has indeed been a bipartisan priority for the past two administrations. Although they have not yet laid out a detailed agenda for U.S.-India relations, the new administration is likely to continue this trend. The administration also includes several members, key players, with very hawkish views with respect to China, and who may continue efforts to recruit India as a counterweight in that relationship. But there are also potential sources of tension between the United States and India over such matters as trade, immigration, and there are questions about the degree to which India would want to take a more confrontational approach towards China in concert with the US. As we all know, and as Dr. Mitra reminded us yesterday during the launch of his book, India has a long history of independent foreign policy, and Indian policymakers are unlikely to forego that independence, even as they continue to work to strengthen bilateral ties between India and the United States. Now, even were we to witness to see a resolution of the Afghan conflict and the tensions there, the tensions in South Asia, as other of our speakers today have pointed out, the tensions in South Asia would persist, driven by the India-Pakistan dispute. For many years, there's been an uneasy equilibrium between India and Pakistan, undergirded by nuclear stalemate, nuclear arsenals, and by the intervention of external benefactors, if you will, on both sides, the US and China. But given its current economic trajectory relative to that of Pakistan, India now has a serious chance of permanently eclipsing Pakistan, assuming that the negative impacts of the demonetization policy can be. India has a much greater ability, therefore, to spend on defense. And India's view regarding Pakistan's relationship with terrorism is now largely accepted in the region and globally. Now, some observers believe that India may therefore see an interest in continuing this current trajectory. As to say, keeping Pakistan locked into and tied to its dominant strategic paradigm, which views India as Islamabad's most central security concern, leaving it blind to other issues. And to that end, it is conceivable that India might push to further isolate Pakistan from the world, and at the same time to prod Pakistan enough to prevent it from changing its current track, while of course not trying to overplay its hand and so that things escalate into a direct conflict. Now I'm reflecting here a perception on the part of people in Washington about how that relationship could evolve. And indeed, this would appear to be the current strategy or approach or policy under the government of Prime Minister Modi, as suggested in the Prime Minister's remarks of last September in Kerala, and the decision, India's decision to skip the meeting of the summit of the South Asian Association of Regional Cooperation in Islamabad last November. So, there are, however, limits to U.S. support for such a strategy, such an approach. Despite real U.S. concerns, there is also continued interest in Washington for maintaining stability in Pakistan, obviously, including access to counterterrorism cooperation and a desire to avoid the risk of nuclear escalation. Ultimately, if we ask ourselves whether we would prefer to have a strained relationship with Pakistan, or one that resembles our relationship with North Korea, clearly, the answer to that question is that we would favor the former. In other words, the U.S. has a profound interest in preventing the relationship with Pakistan from becoming one that resembles that, of course, North Korea, where we are dealing with a rogue nuclear state. Now, many Pakistani policymakers, on the other hand, have held up the China-Pakistan economic corridor as a means of boosting their country's prospects and trying to keep pace with India without having to take steps to normalize relations with India. For the moment, Pakistan seems to have closed off the potential avenues that could give it greater leverage or a way out of its current strategic paradigm, shutting down nascent talks to open up trade with India and transit. And it's also proven, at least thus far, unwilling to address Indian concerns and charges with respect to terrorism, taking only limited actions against such groups as the Lashkar-e-Taiba, and seemingly dragging its feet over the trials of other terrorist groups and suspects. And some believe that this is under the influence of the Pakistani military. So if things continue on this track and Pakistan fails to recognize alternative options, it's not unreasonable to predict that Pakistan-India competition will intensify. This, in turn, will make military tensions and flare-ups tougher to manage, potentially lowering the threshold for nuclear escalation, and certainly increasing the demands on both India and Pakistan for crisis management. It could also likely lead to an increase in proxy conflicts between the two countries in places like Afghanistan and Kashmir. And in a more, if you will, Cold War kind of scenario, it could potentially draw China and the U.S. in more directly as actors and allies backing the opposing sides in their conventional and unconventional conflicts. Now, all of these are risks to further destabilization in the region, and certainly those would all be seen in from the perspective of Washington as threatening to U.S. interests. Now, given all of this, one can imagine a number of scenarios. Let me sketch out three. The first is that U.S. and Pakistan continue to muddle through out of a desire to avoid a complete breach, that Pakistan and China ties could deepen further, and that the current sort of messy equilibrium with India would continue. That's probably the most likely of the scenarios, but it's not the only possibility here. In a second scenario, one could imagine a significant, even a major crisis between Pakistan and India, or alternatively, a stronger push within the US policy community, including from the Congress, for greater pressure, sanctions, censure of Pakistan in response to the situation in Afghanistan. And again, we have on record now General Nicholson's expression of concern about the impact of the Afghan Taliban in Haven in Pakistan and how it has complicated significantly the task for ISAF troops in Afghanistan. And in response to the situation in Afghanistan, this could indeed deepen further Pakistan's isolation. And that, in turn, could increase internal political conflict and increase Pakistani reliance on non-conventional security means, both nuclear and proxy, to counteract that external pressure. A third, I would argue, much more benign and perhaps to be hoped for scenario is that Indian and US policymakers may come to see that the isolation of Pakistan simply doesn't work, and moreover, does not serve their security interests, and that they would therefore seek to re-engage or to intensify their engagement with a view to resolving both the situation in Afghanistan and finding a more harmonious approach or strategy for the future of India-Pakistan relations. But that, as we know, is unlikely to happen unless Pakistan changes its current approach to dealing with terrorism. So right now, there is there is no clear direction from the new administration as regards its approach to South Asia. But these and a number of other issues are liable to pose major challenges, and they will also then in turn shape the way in which the administration attempts to chart, to navigate this very complex set of relationships and issues. Now, I was originally going to end my remarks there, but then I said to myself, I would be remiss if I didn't address one other critical factor that is certain to shape the attitudes and the policies of the new administration. For the most part, up until now, I've talked about things that fall into the realm of objective reality, that is to say, matters that the new administration, any administration, would have to take into account as it defines its approach to the South Asian region. However, there's another element that is arguably more subjective, and that is the administration's view of and approach to Islam and to the Islamic world in general. Those of you who have been following the administration's policy statements will be aware of its use of the term radical Islamic terrorism. Now, on its face, that's a term that can mean any number of things. But the administration has chosen to give it a particular meaning, as used by General Flynn. It was intended to convey the notion that the religion of Islam itself was the source of the extremist ideology that is fueling terrorism throughout the Middle East and beyond. Now, that's a view that is very much at odds with that held by the administrations of both President Obama and President George W. Bush, both of whom argued that the extremist views espoused by groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS were aberrations and perversions of Islam. And of course, General Flynn is no longer a member of the administration, and we know that his view is not one that is shared by other senior officials in the Trump administration, such as the new National Security Advisor, General McMaster, and Defense Secretary, General Mattis. Still, there are other officials in the Trump administration who do share and espouse General Flynn's view, and apparently those would include the president himself. So the question is how this view of Islam and the Islamic world might shape the administration's policies, and equally important, how it might affect the views and attitudes of those in the Muslim world with whom the U.S. would seek to engage. We know, for example, that the government of Iraq took great offense, that Iraq was listed as one of the seven states whose citizens were to be temporarily banned from entering the United States under the administration's initial executive order. And we know that others in the Islamic world have expressed misgivings about the administration's views and their implications. One can imagine that some governments and states where Muslims make up a significant proportion of the population might find it difficult to cooperate enthusiastically with a U.S. administration that appears to see Islam itself as hostile to U.S. interests. And indeed, this may apply to other states as well, including India. States that have the challenge of balancing within their own borders relationships between different communities. So, like so many other things about the new U.S. administration, to what extent this factor takes on in importance remains an open question, adding further to the uncertainties about the future direction of U.S. policies in general, and policies toward South Asia in particular. With that, I will close my remarks, and I look forward to hearing and learning from the comments from members of the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Moose, for those thoughtful comments on the priorities of the Trump administration in the space of foreign policy and security, and what factors might shape that. Our next speaker and the first panelist in this discussion is Dr. Raja Mohan, who is director of Carnegie India. And he comes with a formidable reputation as a foreign policy and security expert with background and rich expertise in the media, in the academia, in think tanks. And David Malone told us an hour ago during that session that he wrote that very influential book, which brought about a paradigm shift in India's foreign policy. Raja was also named by the Foreign Policy Journal in 2009 as one of the top 100 most influential thinkers on international relations. Professor Mohan.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Subbarok. I think for that generous introduction. You also gave us a difficult task of what is it that we take away from this conference room after such a long and productive day that we've had, where we covered so many expansive subjects. And that task is made even more complicated by Ambassador Moose, who's basically told us the U.S. is a variable now. Until now, the assumption was that, look, there was the U.S., with a reasonably stable, steadfast policies, and that the rest of the world was turbulent and would deal, but how the U.S. would deal with this was the general debate in Washington. But today, thanks to the domestic turbulence in the United States, the U.S. is a variable in international politics. So therefore, that further complicates how we think about the future of the subcontinent. I just mentioned one theme. You mentioned the Islamic question towards the end of your thing. You had the president, this whole campaign, they were using the term radical Islamic terrorism. criticizing Obama, saying he refused to use that word. He was using the word, what is it, violent extremism. Now, 2 days ago, the National Security Advisor a few days ago said, no, no, we shouldn't use this word. Let's use radical Islamist terrorism. Very accurate. McMaster is a PhD, as you know. But the president in his Congress speech said it once again, radical Islamic terrorism. And if you look at the text of the speech, R-I-T in capital letters, in case you missed the significance of the term. So I think the uncertainties within the U.S. is going to make our task a lot more difficult as South Asia ponders on its own future in the coming years. I think I won't make a pretense of summarizing what we've done this whole day, but I thought I'll highlight six issues that emerge out of the discussion which are of consequence over the longer term. The first issue I wanted to touch upon was the tension between globalization and deglobalization. Now, if you look at South Asia's recent history, if you go to the 19th century, when under the British Raj, the subcontinent was one of the most globalized places. Very thin layer of the society, but nevertheless, India was deeply globalized, connected to its extended neighborhood. I'll just give you one fact. In the Second World War, 2 million soldiers from undivided India, 2 million soldiers from Indian subcontinent participated and contributed to the victory of the Allies against Japan in this part of the world. And I think it's easy to forget that. Well, you can dismiss that period as a colonial period, but the fact is the South Asian resources, the resources of the undivided subcontinent was so critical in providing security in what we call the Indo-Pacific, in shaping the big outcomes in the world. And I think that fact remained. But I think after the second half of this, in the second half of the 20th century, we consciously deglobalized. When the rest of Southeast Asia was connecting to the world, opening up its markets, the economic choice that first India made and its other neighbors made was to deglobalize. I'm not at this point saying it's good or bad, but that's a fact, that self-reliance, inward orientation was the preferred choice, not just in one country, but across the region. And that led to the deglobalization of the subcontinent. It's only in the 1990s we step out again and reconnect with the world on the economic terms. And I think here, the scale of it, as Dr. Rao pointed out earlier, has been fairly significant. But here is a fact that South Asia is the late globalizer. We were just beginning to see the growth from the globalization that has taken place. Just when we're beginning to feel comfortable, you have one guy who comes in Washington and says, sorry folks, it's over. We're deglobalizing and bye-bye. Now, where does this leave us? I mean, so what kind of strategies do we adapt if Britain, if Europe, if the United States begin to say there's been too much of globalization, there are too many losers from globalization within the West, and that they are a political force that must be addressed, there are consequences for us. So managing that, because I don't think we can abandon globalization, but I think the problem of more restrictive trade, a more inward-looking economies in the West will have significant consequences, and managing that is going to be a major task for us. And I think those of us who do research, I think we need to begin to focus on that. And this can't be done by merely pulling away, but I think, as Dr. Rao pointed out earlier, how do you use innovation to sustain your growth? Because I don't know if South Asia can repeat what the Chinese have done, or that path is going to be closed because of protectionism. What are the alternatives that we have as a late globalizer? How does South Asia sustain its growth? So that is the first point I wanted to make. Second, I think what I said about globalization also applies to diaspora. We normally imagine diaspora as a one-way flow outwards from South Asia. Again, if you go back to the 19th century, expansive movement of Indian labor from Belize or wherever in the Western Hemisphere to Fiji in the deep Indo-Pacific, that you had the Indian labor as part of the globalizing process moving across the subcontinent. It's not just India, the whole of South Asia. And I think that in the post-independence period, it was not a conscious policy, but in spite of the inward-oriented policies, thanks to the Gulf boom, we saw a second wave of movement of Indian people to the Gulf. And there are just 8 million Indians, if you count the Pakistanis and the others, it'll be a lot more. But the fact is, today, we always talk about India, but if you look at South Asian diaspora as a whole, there are more than nearly 35 to 40 million South Asians living beyond their borders. It's a huge number. Now the question is this going to continue to flow outwards, or what happens if the Gulf boom comes to an end? What happens, we get mistaken, as we are likely to be, in the United States for either Mexicans or Middle Easterners, the impact of that. That if there is a feeling, whether it's in Britain or the US, there are too many outsiders amidst or missed, and that there will be significant closing of the Western borders. How much? Merit-based, non-merit-based, religion-based, we don't know. But the fact is, the rest of the world is not going to be as welcoming as it has been to the South Asians in the last 60 years, certainly in the United States after 1965. So today, dealing with that if West begins to put up walls, and then the Gulf begins to go down, then I think, how are we going to deal with the people who are going to come back to India or South Asia? This is going to be a huge problem, and I think we have not even begun to think about it. So therefore, the question is, can we put it to good use, or can we create developmental models that will take care of, that will use the knowledge and other things that these guys have picked up from outside? A third issue, I think, is about connectivity that came up. Again, if you think of the 19th century, the subcontinent was deeply connected to the world in ways in which today we can't imagine that. You had actually, today people talk about the One Belt, One Road. It was a British Raj based in India that did exactly what the Chinese are trying to do now. There was no city called Calcutta. There was no city called Madras. There was no city called Bombay. There was no city called Singapore. There was no city called Hong Kong. There was no city called Aden. But these were built by the logic of globalization of British India, which was seeking to expand the influence of the British economics, but it was not merely a British thing, that it couldn't have been built with the opium grown in India, bad example, nor it could have been done with control without the Indian resources that had to control the instability in this part of the world. So the idea of building new ports, creating new trade routes, creating new corridors, was all this done from the subcontinent into the rest of the Indian Ocean and the Indo-Pacific and Inner Asia. But India, certainly, the whole of South Asia, after independence, we began to shut ourselves down and chose to disconnect ourselves from the neighboring regions. Dr. Rao will know, I don't know when we were printing the Gulf rupee, maybe till 1971 or so, that it was Indian money was legal tender in the Gulf. Today we all think about Chinese currency gaining ground. You inherited actually a structure in which Indian finance, Indian systems were all across, but then we made a conscious choice, this is not ours to keep. But today I think the question then becomes, China is going to lead the connectivity projects, what is it that we're going to do? How are you going to deal with the whole question of connectivity in the region? My sense is that it's contrary to the thing, Belt and Road is only one game in town. It's not as if there are no other alternatives. The Japanese initiative on the so-called PQI, the Partnership for Quality Infrastructure, the Japanese have put as much money as the Chinese on the table. So there is actually, I would say, if someone wants to bring his money, build a road in your country, I would say, welcome, please. And if there are two guys doing it, I would say, more the merrier. How do I use the availability of capital around the world, certainly in Asia itself, between in China and Japan, if they're willing to compete for expansion of infrastructure in South Asia, we should welcome it. And I think it will give us an opportunity to negotiate for better terms. So I would say it's not a question of saying yes or no to the whole initiative. Let's focus on specific individual projects and can we benefit on those projects? And we've seen some reaction in Sri Lanka to something, in Pakistan there's some reaction. So it's not as if the level at which we are talking, is it good or bad? Is it Chinese projection of power or not? But I think we got to go to the next level of analysis, which is specific projects, specific routes, specific proposals that can be, what are the interest rates? How much above LIBOR? What are the terms of operation of these specific port projects? So I think we've not done at that level of analysis, merely saying, we like China, it's great. If you don't like China, it's very bad. So I think there is a whole lot of analysis that needs to be done on a project-specific, individual basis. I would say this opens up huge possibilities for South Asia. We should be unwise not to take advantage. The fourth trend, I think, that has emerged is really a historic shift in power around the subcontinent. Because for 150 years, our argument was against the Western dominance of this part. Through the colonial age, after decolonization, the main argument, at least in India, not everywhere, that's not true of every other country, the so-called Indian strategic autonomy David was referring to, it was about saying we can't get too close to the West. You dominated us, now we are free, so it's a way of demonstrating my freedom. But others, it was useful, right? To my neighbors, a lot of them, Pakistan joined Seattle, CENTO, as a way of balancing India. But the fact is, the West, how you dealt with the West was a principal strategic question in the subcontinent in the second half of the 20th century. But today, the rise of China becomes the principal factor shaping our balance of power around the subcontinent. Because every single country has China as the largest trading partner. Chinese arms are beginning to come into our neighborhood. While earlier Chinese sold stuff at friendship prices, but today the quality, the purpose of the consequence of Chinese strategic engagement in the neighborhood is going to be significant. It's not just in Pakistan, where Pakistan was the first one to demonstrate the value of that relationship. Today, I suppose everyone sees China as interesting, useful, not always attractive perhaps, but a useful way of actually doing things in the subcontinent. And that in turn sets the stage for a significant competition for influence within the subcontinent. Not as much as the Americans, between China and India itself, because it's one thing to talk about non-alignment and strategic autonomy with distant powers, when the second largest economy is next door, and what it does in the region, then it is no longer about some distant power play, we're going to keep neutral, this is next door, it is going to, that heat is getting to us. So therefore, how India deals with it is going to be a very important thing, and already you're seeing some of it. That, of course, poses interesting questions to some of the smaller countries. I'm saying this with great sensitivity, so please bear with me. You can be Ukraine and believe that you're getting into NATO and you can provoke Russia, there's certain consequences. But you can be like India and use the same example and say, you know, muck around too much in Ukraine, then you get under sanctions, you lose regional support and international consequences. So the fine balance between how do smaller countries around a large country deal with outside powers? It's not a unique to the subcontinent. It is true in Asia, in East Asia. It's true, always been in Europe. So therefore, I think what the Chinese power does in subcontinent and its consequences is going to be very, very serious one. And I think that would structure a whole lot of relationships between states and within states, because there's interesting competition that develops within the domestic politics of each country. You've seen some of that in Sri Lanka. You're going to see some of that in other places. We've seen that in Maldives. So internal politics are not going to be immune to the major power competition within South Asia. On the fifth point is about looking east and looking west. Two of our sessions dealt with, one is to look east, one is to look west. But if you go back to the 19th century again, or right up to 1945, India was the principal security provider. When I say India, it's undivided India, was the principal security provider in this part of the world. Right from Aden to Singapore and beyond, that the impact of the subcontinent in securing this part, and it was called the India Center. But of course, partition broke it up. And as a consequence, the energies of the subcontinent went inwards, directed at itself to defend the new borders, to deal with a new, freshly emerging crisis within the subcontinent, and I think that is the problem. But today, in the last 15 years at least, we're beginning to talk about transcending some of this partition and looking at reconnecting the regions, restoring through free trade and a whole range of other arrangements, not entirely successful, but the whole question of that the subcontinent gets reconnected to its neighboring regions. There, I think a lot is going to happen, and I'm going to come back to the last point. And then finally, the question of internal coherence. This point has been raised repeatedly. Is South Asia going to be a coherent region internally? The idea that we must do something together, we need to do more to integrate the region, is a good sentiment, but my fear is we are moving towards greater fragmentation. A Pakistan that feels it's more important to do CPEC than trade with India. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I mean, everybody's free to make their sovereign choices. Once those choices get made, there will be consequences in terms of where the flows of economic flows are going to be. If some borders are going to be closed, some borders are going to be opened, there will be consequences for the long term, and that is going to have significant outcomes. Similarly, the Sri Lankan Prime Minister talks about, we're not just a South Asian country. We're an Indian Ocean country. We are a Bay of Bengal country. So I think people are beginning to be tired of SAARC, might be how much or noble your sentiments might be. You want to get on with life. India goes to BIMSTEC, Sri Lanka says we're an Indian Ocean country, Pakistan says CPEC is great. So you're stuck in a situation where actually the notion of a coherent South Asia itself is going to be in doubt. And I think dealing with that potential possibility, can we prevent it? Can we restore some restore the logic of regional integration? Or there's going to be, all of us are going to look at different directions for future integration. That, I think, is the last challenge. So I'll stop here, so I've taken a bit of extra time.
Thank you very much, Professor Raja Mohan, for that historical perspective on South Asia and the rest of the world on six dimensions. And after listening to you, we understand why you're so influential. Thank you very much. Our next panelist is Professor Razeen Sally, who is Associate Professor at the LKY School of Public Policy and also Chairman of the Institute of Policy Studies, the main economic policy think tank in Sri Lanka. His written, spoken, thought, researched extensively on trade issues and also on a very rare academic sphere, which is history of economic ideas. Next book is coming out this year, right, in 2017. Professor Sally.
Thank you very much, Dr. Subbarao. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Well, the last two speakers have spoken about South Asia and the world. I'm going to be very anticlimactic here. I'm not a South Asia expert, so I'm not qualified to talk at that level. I'm going to talk about one country in particular, Sri Lanka. And it might not look it, but I am half Sri Lankan. I do have a Sri Lankan connection and have worked in Sri Lanka quite a lot since the change of government 2 years ago. So what I would like to do in my 15 minutes on South Asia in microcosm, one country, Sri Lanka, is to provide an assessment on what has happened in the 2 years and 2 months since regime change, when 10 years of the rule of the Rajapaksa family ended, to look at the state of play as well as prospects for Sri Lanka on politics, on the economy, on foreign policy, and of course not least on ethnic relations. And I'm going to do that by portraying three scenarios of Sri Lanka's future. The first scenario I have in mind is drift. That's to say a continuation of the present. I'll explain shortly. The second scenario is one of takeoff, an economic takeoff. And a third scenario is of relapse. So let me go through those three before I close. And I'll start with the first one, scenario one of drift. What does Sri Lanka look like now, 2 years and a bit after regime change? And what are its prospects with this scenario in mind? Where are we now in Sri Lanka? It's a bit better than it was, is my broad assessment, but not nearly as much improved as it should be, not by a long shot. What are the credits? Well, firstly, the political system has returned to some sort of liberality, having descended quite sharply into authoritarian politics under the Rajapaksa regime. So people breathe more freely, people do not disappear in the middle of the night in white vans as they did just over 2 years ago. There's been a 19th Amendment to the Constitution, there's a new constitution in the works. The media is pretty free these days. Ethnic relations, symbolically, the right overtures have been made to the minorities. Tensions are not nearly as great as they were before, but the underlying issues have still not been resolved. And the last major credit, foreign policy in Sri Lanka has been rebalanced. So while it was very much in the China camp under the Rajapaksas, relations have been repaired pretty well with both India and the West. So it is more balanced. That said, there are significant debits. The first is on politics. This government came into power promising in Sinhala Yahal Palanaya, which means good governance. Well, Sri Lanka has not returned to good governance. It still has bad governance and a lot of corruption and nepotism. I'd say it's pretty much returned to pre-Rajapaksa levels. On ethnic relations, as I said before, the underlying issues have not been resolved. On land restitution, on the role of the military in the economy, and on what's called transitional justice, given the human rights abuses during the war, particularly in its end phase. The major Achilles heel, I think, in Sri Lanka is the economy, because the expectations that were raised of an economic turnaround with regime change simply have not been met. What has gone wrong? To begin with, macroeconomic policy. Since independence, Sri Lanka has had a problem with cutting its coat of clothing to its cloth. It's been macroeconomically profligate, starting with fiscal policy. That continued under this government with two really bad budgets. Monetary policy was very politicized, basically accommodating overgenerous fiscal policy. That put pressure on the exchange rate and on twin deficits. All of that required an IMF standby loan, which continues, which has stabilized the situation somewhat, without addressing the fundamental things that are wrong with fiscal policy in particular. Sri Lanka is in a sort of productivity trap. It had debt-fueled growth under the last government, reliant very much on the public sector and external loans, not least from China. What Sri Lanka needs is sustainable growth through productivity coming from a private sector engine and an external engine, that's to say trade and foreign investment. Now, what that requires are significant reforms, but they haven't really materialized so far in terms of improving the domestic business climate and also in terms of liberalizing trade and foreign investment. There are other structural reforms that need addressing in Sri Lanka, just as they do in other parts of South Asia. The labor market is far too rigid. It's difficult to hire and fire. There are serious land issues. Sri Lanka is perhaps the worst in South Asia in having a bloated public sector. It's 1.5 million employees in a workforce of about 8 million. That's probably the largest ratio in South Asia, and it's a huge drag on the economy. These are things that are politically, of course, very sensitive to address. They haven't been addressed predictably. So that's just a flavor of the things that haven't been done on economic policy reform. Economy is not just lacks competitiveness, there simply isn't enough competition in most parts of the economy. This government came into power without an economic plan as such, and it still hasn't really materialized. The final point I'm worried about in terms of the state of play is foreign policy drift towards China. That again addresses a broader theme of today's event. Initially, relations were bad with China because the Chinese government supported the previous Sri Lankan government. But those relations have been right royally repaired, I can tell you, over the past year or so. The projects that were suspended are now back on track in Colombo and in Hambantota. And the Chinese government, through its embassy, is very busy spreading a lot of money around in Colombo and elsewhere, which gets into the hands of local political and commercial elites. That, of course, is a common story across the subcontinent and indeed in this part of the world. And all of this is happening without serious investment coming in. Sorry, 2 minutes? are you serious about 2 minutes? I thought I was given 15. Chairman, it's up to you. Do you want me to?
Maybe another 5 minutes.
Another 5 minutes, okay. So let me abbreviate my remarks. What I'm worried about is that China is the only big game in town as far as Sri Lanka is concerned. There isn't compensating private sector, more productive investment coming in from India or the West. And that has serious economic as well as national security implications. Now, why have things not fundamentally changed in Sri Lanka despite regime change? I mean, I would offer three major reasons. The first is complacency. There's an ode from Horace, "Happy is he to whom nature has given with a sparing hand." That, of course, applies to Singapore and Hong Kong. It doesn't apply to abundant Sri Lanka. And it has a curse of complacency which just pervades the elite and general culture in Sri Lanka, particularly Sinhala Buddhist culture. Secondly, the political class in Sri Lanka remains fundamentally unchanged despite changes of government with elections. What Sri Lanka really needs, in my view, is a new generation to break through doing things differently in the political system. But of course, that's something incumbents resist. That's Sri Lanka's biggest institutional challenge. Very finally, what we see in the political class is reflected in a business class, which is still dominated by an old elite with, of course, very strong political connections. There isn't a breakthrough from younger, more entrepreneurial types. So the prospect, one scenario, is that this situation will just continue, drift will continue. Sri Lanka will always face crisis around the corner on the economy, on ethnic relations, but without facing a blow-up overall. That's one scenario. The second scenario is one of economic takeoff, which is what many young Sri Lankans and aspirational Sri Lankans were hoping for with regime change. That is primarily about an economic takeoff, moving up to, say, 6 to 8% rates of growth from 5% and a bit at the moment. It requires a productivity engine of the private sector and much more trade and much more foreign investment. That requires all the big policy reforms that I talked about that I haven't really materialized. All of that's necessary to keep the pie growing so that ethnic relations can be repaired, because the really big danger of a stagnant pie is that it will exacerbate those ethnic fault lines that Sri Lanka has had for a long time. And that was a very significant contributory factor to both the Tamil rebellion in the north and the Sinhala rebellions in the south. And finally, this positive scenario is about foreign policy being properly balanced. In other words, having solid relations with India and the West, particularly in terms of private sector involvement in Sri Lanka's economy, to balance what is happening with China. And let's not forget, very finally, I state this plainly, if Sri Lanka aspires to be a liberal democracy and an open society, then India and the West are its civilizational friends, not China. However, the sad news, I think, is that this scenario is not on the cards. I wouldn't bet on it. The final scenario, very quickly, is one of relapse. That's to say, a return to the kind of conditions that existed before regime change on January the 8th, 2015, which might happen with a presidential victory for a Rajapaksa or some big man of that ilk who would return Sri Lanka to very serious authoritarian politics, a sort of echo of Vladimir Putin's Russia. That also would be a return to a state-led, a statist economy, which is a recipe for stagnation. It would be a return to a Sinhala Buddhist chauvinist agenda, which raises the specter of tensions and perhaps conflict between the majority and the minorities, and all the communities returning to their solitudes, as it were, to use a Canadian expression. And very finally, servitude to China on foreign policy. where we would see an acceleration of the kind of drift that we've been seeing recently. My very final summary point is this. I don't think that scenario of drift, in other words, an extrapolation of the present, is, as we economists would put it, a stable equilibrium. And that's not how Sri Lanka works. I think the present situation is unstable and could easily revert, unless some things are done critically, in a fairly narrow window within the next year or two. Things could revert to scenario three rather than scenario two. That's to say, a nationalist, a singular nationalist revival. And with that, I will close my remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sally, for those insightful comments on the three possible future scenarios of Sri Lanka. You were right to point out many challenges and express concern about them. But we also must recognize that as much as Sri Lanka has compelling challenges, it also has substantive, impressive achievements in terms of the HDI index, etc. So Sri Lanka has challenges, but also has accomplishments. Our final speaker, and importantly for this evening, is Professor K.S. Nathan, who is a distinguished fellow at the Institute of Diplomacy and Foreign Relations, and also a senior researcher at the Institute of Ethnic Studies in the National University of Malaysia. He's affiliated to a number of academic institutions and think tanks, both in Malaysia and around the world. Professor Nathan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a great pleasure to be invited to this distinguished conference and to serve on this panel. And it's also a privilege to be the last speaker for today. Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, this is the graveyard shift. As you can see, the crowd usually diminishes, but there is enough active interest, and it's really wonderful that so many of you can still persevere and stay behind for the entire conference. After all, the study of South Asia and Southeast Asian interactions is also very much about endurance and perseverance. So we continue to persevere and see how we can perform better as we move on and go forward. The subject of my presentation, I don't know whether the slides can move or not, but if not, then I will just present from here. The subject of my presentation is very much an IR approach, the strategic role of defense and diaspora in strengthening India-ASEAN linkages. Well, India is the largest actor and the most powerful actor in South Asia, so I will focus on India simply because I am much more competent to talk about India-ASEAN relations. And of the five Ds that formed the organizing principle of this conference, diplomacy, development, democracy, defense and diaspora, I will focus on defense and diaspora, just the other two Ds. So the aim of my paper, ladies and gentlemen, is to assess the role, impact, and future potential of defense and diaspora in India-Southeast Asia interactions in the context of India's rising role as a regional and also global power. And secondly, to make some observations on how the Indian diaspora in Southeast Asia can be a strategic asset to India's foreign policy and national interests, and also in shaping the character and trend of India-ASEAN relations, and more broadly, South Asia, Southeast Asia interactions in the years ahead. Now, very briefly, looking at the growing linkages between India and ASEAN, clearly they have been rising over the last two decades. This engagement has, of course, been augmented by the Lucky's policy of India since 1992. And there has also been a substantial increase in India-ASEAN cooperation after India's accession to the Treaty of Amity and Cooperation of ASEAN in 2003. So India over the past 20 years has emerged as an important political, security and economic partner of ASEAN. So this rising economic and military power of China also at the same time and its growing assertiveness in the South China Sea provides added incentives for India and ASEAN to shape the balance of power in promoting our mutual interests. Now, ASEAN and India view each other's expanding international capacity for sub-regionalism and broader Asia-wide regionalism as opening up many new frontiers for closer engagement and cooperation. The Indo-Pacific region, as you know, today represents the conjunction of the strategic interests of six major political entities: USA, China, India, Japan, Russia, and ASEAN. Now, where is the convergence between India and ASEAN? I think there are certain strategic perspectives that both share and which has actually brought them closer together. One is rejection of big power hegemonism. B is concern over China's muscle flexing in the South China Sea as it carries the potential of a wider conflagration. C, upgrading regional cooperation on non-traditional security issues. That's nice, it's up there now. Especially maritime piracy and trafficking of drugs, women and children. D, viewing the EAS process, that is the East Asia Summit process, which was of course initiated by ASEAN, as yet another forum for member countries to discuss strategies to maintain and expand the concept of open regionalism, which we practice in Southeast Asia, as the major driver of regional integration, embracing the notion of inclusivity and cooperative security. Pretty much, very much an ASEAN contribution, the concept of inclusivity and also cooperative security. And E, addressing collectively issues from globalization, the next slide, namely climate change and its impact on food and human security. F, strengthening counter-terrorism cooperation. G, containing proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. H, strengthening the cooperative mechanism on the Straits of Malacca and Singapore, in which India as a partner is contributing to two of the six IMO projects for enhancement of navigational safety and environmental protection in the Straits. And lastly, maritime security cooperation. India and ASEAN countries have been participating in the multilateral exercise in the Indian Ocean, this was also mentioned earlier, since 2007, which is actually a post 9/11 initiative. Now let's look at India-ASEAN defense cooperation and security cooperation from the look-east policy now to the act-east policy. Now, I think Mr. Raj Shankar, I think, has also mentioned this already earlier, Raj Shankar, in his earlier presentation, and there are some points of convergence in what he has already said. He also covered defense and security linkages that India has built up with Southeast Asia and also other parts of the world. The ADMM Plus, as you know, ASEAN Defense Ministers Meeting Plus, which started in 2013, it brings together ASEAN and then all the other major dialogue partners of ASEAN into one security forum where they discuss cooperation on common issues affecting the region. Then you have the expanded ASEAN Maritime Forum. So India is definitely very much engaged with issues in Southeast Asia. And this was actually a 1.5 or track. It's sort of an unofficial track, 1.5 diplomacy, that focuses on all those issues, such as even the issue of the South China Sea, China's island building, and so on, and the need for UNCLOS to be the framework by which we deal with maritime security issues and issues affecting non-traditional security. Now, for India, what happens in the South China Sea is clearly very important. Over 40% of India's trade traverses through the South China Sea. Now, in terms of security cooperation, India is very much engaged with the ASEAN Regional Forum, which is a multilateral security forum, as you know, which was born after the end of the Cold War and the need for strengthening security dialogues, emphasizing more soft security rather than hard security. Trying to find consensus in the ASEAN Regional Forum, as you know, is a big challenge because there are 27 members. But India and all the other major actors are all included in the ASEAN Regional Forum, promoting the concept of cooperative security, something that ASEAN has really contributed in Southeast Asia towards how we can look at broader security concerns. Now, India, of course, has started also the Milan exercises. It's a multilateral naval exercise since 1995, clearly exercising with many of the ASEAN navies to promote, again, common security, counterterrorism cooperation, and so on. And also now, with President Trump talking about, as he uses the word, radical Islamic terrorism, he wants to extinguish it. There is more a convergence, I think, among the major powers. This would also include Russia. It would include China. It would include all the major states of the nation, because transnational threats are a threat to the existing international system based on the nation state. So there's a lot of convergence, and I think somebody also mentioned that US-India cooperation, especially in the dimension of security, can be expected to increase under President Trump. Now, under the Act East policy, India is strengthening economic, political, and security cooperation with the CLMV countries, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Vietnam, which are also less developed than the other ASEAN members. So strengthening India-ASEAN connectivity. Connectivity was also mentioned very often yesterday and today. Air, land, and sea connectivity under the ASEAN-India Strategic Partnership. Now, which was signed, of course, in 2012, now, this is being accelerated under the present Modi government. Now, other important avenues of India-ASEAN security cooperation are the CSCAP, yeah, the Shangri-La Dialogue, and also the Delhi Dialogue, and many other forums which have already been mentioned. So I would move on quite quickly because there is some signal given there. Let me focus on diaspora. Now, in the area of diaspora, clearly, India has been looking outward since liberalization, in which foreign direct investment is one of the most important components. In the 1970s, the FDI was hardly 3%, and now the share has gone up to 30%. Diaspora, as India also sees it, is one of the key players in the FDI today. India is the largest receiver of remittance in the world today, and thus the Indian diaspora's prosperity is one of the attractions for mutual engagement which has been realized since the 1990s. The impact of India's rise, as you can see, with innovation, modern communications, advanced transportation, and increased levels of mobility, as well as increased opportunities in management, professions, business, and entrepreneurship in a growing India, there is re-migration that is taking place. And this two-way process has strengthened the people-to-people connectivity between India and Southeast Asia. The Indian diaspora reflects the socio-economic and cultural diversities of India. They are spread out over 136 countries across the globe. The diaspora, through their political, economic, technological, commercial, and intellectual acumen, and if wisely used, can certainly make a positive impact on the host countries, such as Malaysia and Singapore, where they are numerically significant, and also in the country of origin, which is India. In this way, the diaspora can influence the foreign policies and international relations of both countries. I think Malaysia, as an example in Southeast Asia, which has about 2 million Indians in Malaysia out of 30 million, clearly has a very strong diasporic element, and that has been used even by our Prime Minister to strengthen economic cooperation, technological cooperation, building of infrastructure in India and also Malaysia by companies on both sides. So the diaspora is clearly seen as a positive factor in the bilateral relationship. Let me move on very quickly. In Southeast Asia, while the earlier historical migration of Indians into the region was labor intensive, the contemporary migration, ladies and gentlemen, is marked more by a skill-intensive character. The role of human capital in India, Southeast Asia, diasporic engagement has become more important. The flood of Indian labor, as you know, has been particularly significant in a variety of sectors, including technology, the IT sector, academia, banking, oil and gas. Let me try, move on quickly. So you can see the figure for the diasporic sort of spread in Southeast Asia and the countries where there is the larger presence. Yeah, I'll just go very quickly and conclude. And this brings me to the point made by Dr. David Malone earlier about the challenge of implementation, how India can cohere its internal and external policies to really produce power and project itself as an important actor. The Indian diaspora can only be a strategic asset if certain criteria are properly addressed. India needs to overhaul its international trade policy to take advantage of overseas trade networks developed by its diaspora through migration and settlement over several decades. India needs to undertake major institutional and policy reforms to make the domestic environment more conducive to diasporic re-migration and investment in the Indian economy. In this way, the diaspora in Southeast Asia can be a significant asset to India's economy and foreign policy. All right, let me just conclude now with the final 3 points. Now, over the past two decades, India clearly has upgraded its political, economic, security, and cultural context and cooperation with the ASEAN states. India-ASEAN defense cooperation and diasporic interactions have gained greater attention and salience in augmenting regional stability and development. Second point, the web of interdependence between South Asia and Southeast Asia has expanded under the Look East policy and now under the Act East policy, and also ASEAN's desire for greater maneuverability in ensuring a more equitable involvement and engagement of the major external powers in this region. Finally, this outward-looking orientation on both sides, that is on ASEAN as well as India, and the mutual goal of strengthening the India-ASEAN strategic partnership is likely to continue as regional as well as external powers adjust to ongoing global as well as regional power transitions in Asia. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Nathan, and our apologies for rushing you through what has been a very painstakingly researched paper on looking at India and ASEAN convergence on diaspora and defense. I'm disappointed to say that we've run out of time. The organizers of the conference have told me that because the earlier sessions had run out, overrun their time, this session has become a hostage to that, and we do not have time for Q&A. And I want to apologize to the panelists for all the research and all the effort that you put into it, but we do hope that there'll be opportunities for us and ISAS to interact with you today and on future occasions. So please join me in giving a hand of applause to all our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Subbarao, and our eminent panelists for that concise discussion. Once again, ISAS is extremely grateful to all panelists for their gracious consideration of the time constraints and for concluding the panel. I would now like to invite Dr. Subbarao to present the panel of speakers with tokens of appreciation. First, Ambassador George Moose. Next, Dr. Mohan. Associate Professor Sally. And Professor Nathan. Ladies and gentlemen, as